Okay, I have here the the derivations which most of you have already done, but this is of course a special case when alpha 1 equal to alpha 2 equal to alpha, right? So let me see if I can. I think my pen has stopped working, so I'll need to restart. But you guys can be here on the call. I'll just restart the. Okay, now it's working. Okay. Right. So this is supposed to be of the special case when alpha 1 equal to alpha 2 equal to alpha, right? And most of you have done this derivation until the end, except probably a couple of you. But I think I have already discussed this in class, how this goes, right? So you have one received power to be greater than the other received power. The one which is the lower received power, that distance necessarily has to be greater than some point, right? This is quite obvious that if you want to have your received power less than something, that means the distance is supposed to be greater than something because it decreases with the distance, the received power. And what it turns out is the distance that the second base station has to be, the nearest base station of the second tire has to be greater than, is a function of the first tire's base station distance, which itself is a random quantity. So basically, we have to take an expectation with respect to it. This from here to here is followed from the CDF of D2, which is e to the minus pi lambda 2 r square, whatever r is. In this case, it's p1 by p2 to the minus 1 by alpha. And when we take an expectation with respect to it, we just simply multiply, we have that term and multiply it with 2 pi lambda x e to the minus pi lambda 1 x square, which is the PDF of D1, right? And from here, the result naturally follows if you do a bit of substitution. So we substitute this entire term with t. So these kind of integrals, I think you have already done in your school days, but here we will be using a lot of it, especially when we have exponential of some terms and we have the difference. So if I call this term as some x and we have x dash dx, something like this here, right? So this becomes interesting because you can take this one as something and then the other part follows naturally. Okay, so that's what we have done. We have taken the exponent to be some t, and since there is this x square term and its differentiation is present in the other term, the integration directly follows. This is where most of you have ended up. I mean, of course, not the ones who have taken alpha 1 and alpha 2 differently, but from the point where we start to take them equal. And it's natural, it's generally true for similar frequencies that the path loss exponents are similar. So path loss exponent mostly depends on the frequency of operation and the surroundings around you, right? And for two different tires present in the same surroundings operating in similar frequencies, the alpha naturally can be the same. P1 and P2 might well be different, okay? It can be of, as I was mentioning a while ago, it can be of different operators. In that case, P1 might be equal to P2. But if it is in the case of the same operator, that means we are comparing basically a larger tower, which sometimes is called the macro base station tower. So these terms we will be using in today's class. Macro base station tire. Or small cells, which are installed on top of buildings and so on. This we will be calling as small cell base station tire. In such cases, if these are the two tires against whom we are comparing, with which the user is getting connected to, naturally they operate with quite different powers, right? So this is the probability that we have derived, or P1 is the probability that you are going to associate or we are going to connect to tire one. Okay. A few things which are very clear from here is that in case P1 equal to P2, so for P1 equal to P2, sorry, let's call this connection one. Okay, C1 is simply, and I think almost all of you have derived this, is lambda 1 by lambda 1 plus lambda 2. Okay. It's a very elegant expression, and it is again intuitively satisfying because this represents the fraction of base stations which belong to tier 1 out of all the total base stations, right? Remember that if we are looking at all the total base stations and their locations as a combined Poisson point process, which means a superposition of phi 1 and phi 2. So this is the phi 1 and phi 2. Remember our result that phi 1 union phi 2, that is the point process belonging to or point process denoting the locations of all base stations in the network, that also constitutes a Poisson point process with intensity lambda 1 plus lambda 2. So this denominator is basically representative of all the points that are present in the network. The numerator, on the other hand, represents the fraction of those which are, it represents the tier 1 type base station. So this basically represents the fraction of base stations which are of tier 1. Although none of you have done it, but did anyone try to do the MATLAB simulations even after the quiz? Yes, no? So this is something I would like you to do on your own, because again, this I have already explained. So what are the things that I have already covered in simulations? I have explained simulation of Poisson point processes, right? I have done an SINR coverage analysis, both analytical and simulation of one tier in one dimensions. So using this previously discussed things of the simulated form of the network, I would like you to redo the question of the quiz. In case you did not have time to do it during the quiz, just try to simulate or just try to find out what would be this value of C1 as you vary lambda 1 in the x-axis and confirm it with the simulated versions. Okay. Then we can discuss it during the office hours as well. One important thing that you can think about from here is that, what do you think will happen to C1 if lambda 1 increases? So the question is, if lambda 1 increases, does C1 always increase? Does it decrease sometime? What happens? How do you find it?
So here we can divide both numerator denominator by lambda 1. Then if lambda 1 increases, lambda 1 increases, so lambda 2 by lambda 1 would decrease, so denominator would decrease.
So if lambda 1 increases, C1 increases, right? So following the same, let's say, viewpoint, we can see that if P1 also increases, the C1 also increases, which means if the probability of connecting to tier 1 increases, if you increase the density of those tier 1 base stations, also if you increase the power of transmission of those tier 1 base stations. Okay, these are very obvious, and although it's a very simple expression, it gives you these kind of very simple results. What we would want to discuss on today's class is that we have seen from this previous discussion that what dictates the association of these base of these users to these base stations is the power and the densities. But the question is it always a good idea to connect with a base station which is giving you the highest received power? Okay, very briefly, I had explained it in the previous class or the end of the previous class. I had given one circumstance when it would not be a good idea to do that. And that case was when there are densely deployed base stations around you of some tier, right? So let's call these blue markers to be one tier and this red X's to be other tiers, right? Here, the nearest base station, probably this guy, is giving probably a larger received power as compared to this red base station. However, when you go into the performance analysis, which we have previously, as previously discussed, it was the SINR coverage and subsequently the rate coverage, it might not always be a good idea to connect to a blue one because of a large number of interfering base stations also located nearby. Apart from this, there is an additional problem which we will be starting our discussion on of today's class is this fact that sometimes when there is a mismatch of powers, right? So for example, you have a coverage area of a large base station, let us denote it like this, right? The issue which a network operator might have found out is that the users which are outside a certain radius, let's call it this radius, so the users which are located inside this blue shaded region as discussed before sometimes are called cell center users, which means the users which are closer to the base station as compared to, or statistically closer to the base station as compared to the total number of users. So suppose the users which are located inside this blue shaded region have a good coverage. However, the users which are located outside of it are having very weak signals from its base station. And accordingly, what the operator has decided is that it will be deploying a small cell base station near the network edge or near the cell edge in order for it to create its own coverage area, right, around the around the cell edges, right? This is just to extend the coverage. Okay, the motivation for deploying such small cells around the cell edge, is it clear? It's just to have a, yeah, someone has a question?
Yeah, not a question, sir. I was sitting. Yeah.
Okay. The issue, however, is that as we saw, that when there is a big mismatch of power, let's say this guy is transmitting with the power P1 and this guy is transmitting with the power P2, the coverage of this guy, the base station which is transmitting with the power P2, is largely limited when P1 is very much greater than P2. It generally happens that these larger base stations have a very good power source associated to it. And as a result, it can afford to be transmitting with a larger power. The small cells, however, you would want the other users which are around this cell edge not only to get this coverage, but also you would want some of these users. Suppose you consider this case of very densely deployed user processes, okay, which means these users are a lot in number and they are also spread throughout this network area in a very dense manner. In that case, you would want some of this traffic, which previously dependent on these base station, the macro base station, to be offloaded. So this is a term we will be using to this small cell base station. Okay. So the idea is twofold. One, not only it is true that these smaller base stations are deployed around the cell edge to extend the coverage of the macro base station, but also you would want some users which were previously overburdening the macro base station, right, by connecting to it, because and more the users that connect to a certain base station, the more resources this base station has to provision for those users, right? You would want such users to be serviced by this smaller base station, right, so that there is a good balance of the users between these two base stations. However, since the P2 is very much small as compared to P1, it will have a very small coverage area. The smaller base station has a very small coverage area. In those cases, what the operator does, and this is a concept which is not new to 5G, it existed in 4G as well as in some versions in before 4G, like 3G and all, is called cell range expansion. So is there anyone who has heard about this term? Has anyone heard about this term, cell range expansion?
No, sir.
Okay, no problem. So the idea is this. So suppose you have a macro base station which is similar to the one which I was discussing at length right now, and it has its own coverage area, let's say like this, and you have a small cell base station and its coverage area is like this. How is this boundary decided? This is the boundary at which, if a user is present, it gets equal power from both this small cell base station as well as the macro base station, right? If it is towards the out of this inner circle, it connects to this macro base station because it provides it the higher received power. And if it is inside the circle, of course, it connects to the small cell base station. The idea of cell range expansion is to artificially augment these coverage area of the small cell to a larger extent, such that the users which lie in this extended coverage area now get connected to the small cell. Okay, why do we do it? Remember that even if you are artificially increasing this coverage area of this small cell, these users, which means you are forcefully taking them away from this macro base station connection. So previously this was the service link. You are taking them away from this macro base station and putting them forcefully inside the small cell base station coverage area, right? Because this extended blue boundary, which is blue minus the black boundary, this area, which is called the cell range expanded area or the expanded coverage area, the users lying in this area previously were having a larger received power from the macro base station. Okay. While getting their services, they will still have a larger received power from the macro base station. However, in order to increase the number of users that are covered by this small cell, so the motivation is to increase the number of users covered by the small cell, the received power and hence the coverage area of the small cell is virtually increased. Okay, so in the documents that we will be studying throughout this course, or if you go to, let's say, any communications company, and I mean especially network operators company, the term that many times would be used is, apart from this cell range expansion, it is also called load balancing. It is also sometimes called offloading. And the idea is very straightforward. You are taking some load off of the macro base station and you are putting those load into the small cells which you have now deployed. Remember that while service, this is just for association, okay, which means during defining with which base station you are going to associate to, you are virtually increasing the power of the small cells. However, after the association has taken place, when you have commenced your service, it will always be with the actual received power, which means for association, if you are in, if we call this base station to be belonging to tier 5-1 and this base station belonging to tier 5-2, your coverage 2, which means the probability you are associating to a base station of tier 5-2, which is C2, is the probability that the received power from the small cell base station, which is basically P2 K times D2 to the minus alpha. Previously, we were thinking about whether it is greater than P1 K D1 minus alpha or not. But now we have an additional term, which we will be calling the bias. You can denote it. Sometimes in practice, it is denoted by Q. Sometimes in practice, it's denoted by B. But since in our course, we will be denoting B by bandwidth, or we will be denoting bandwidth by B, we will use Q to denote the bias. Ah, there is another term to it called biasing. So this Q, and to denote that it is multiplied with the tire phi 2, we will denote it by Q2. So Q2 is this additional parameter. Let me write it with a different color. So this is the additional parameter, sometimes called the bias factor, right, with which now this power received from the second tire or the small cell tire is virtually augmented by while comparing for the purpose of association. It's a very simple technique. There is nothing much to it, but there are some ways of interpreting what this Q2 is what makes it a bit more interesting. Okay, so until this point, is there any question?
So basically, sir, we are associating with this augmented expression, and after the association is done, we are removing the Q2 to use the original power for the service.
Yes. So once you are absolutely correct. Once you have already associated, that after that, while you calculate the SINR and rate coverage, you will not consider Q2 anymore. Was this your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So okay, as it turns out, my pen has indeed stopped working. I'll try to restart it. But meanwhile, can you try to tell me, or can you try to envisage what would be the impact of this Q2 on your association? So, for example, if I plot C2 versus Q2, right? What do you think would happen? Anyone?
So C2 is that probability for phi 2.
Yeah, C2 is the term which you are multiplying with the power you received from phi 2.
So if Q increases, then my bias towards my phi 2 would increase, so C2 should increase.
That's correct. So then after association, suppose you are trying to find out the SINR coverage probability, right, of this user, right? So suppose I plot this SINR coverage probability in the y-axis with C2, with Q2 in the x-axis, what do you think would happen?
Sir, I think with high value of Q2, we should have low SINR.
Okay, so and with very low, what happens when in the case of low value of Q2?
I think then it should be comparable in the actual SINR that was before.
Sorry, can you repeat? So suppose Q2 equal to 0, what happens then?
In that case, I would be connecting with macro or phi 1.
You are always connecting to phi 1, right? Mm-hmm. And now suppose I increase from Q2 equal to 0 to Q2 equal to 1. What do you think would happen? Or let's say I am changing Q2 from 0 onwards until infinite. Okay, so Q2 is a positive parameter which we are multiplying with this received power. Suppose I increase this Q2 from 0 towards infinite, do you think there will be a maximum value where the SINR is maximized?
I I think SINS should be maximized at 1.
Then why is that?
Because that was the original boundary. At the boundary here.
At that point, I would be connect equal probability to connect both to micro and macro.
That's not really true, right? And it's not equal.
I mean, equal power I would be getting.
Mm-hmm.
So my power would be like I'm getting equally equal power from my micro and my micro. But probability obviously depends on that D1 also.
Yes, and why do you think that would mean that we maximize when our Q2 equal to 1? I hope the question is clear, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I mean the things that you have mentioned are absolutely correct, but just to understand why this is happening is what happens when Q2 is greater than 1? When Q2 is greater than 1, right, that means you are taking such users, which means this blue boundary is outside the black boundary. That means you are taking users away from the macro base station and putting them into the small cells. What do I mean by away from the macro base stations? These users previously were getting maximum power from the macro base station. And if you remember, our SINR term this interference consisted of other such signals from other base stations. When you are doing cell range expansion, whether Q2 is greater than 1 or less than 1, you are effectively taking one of such SIs for some users, of course not for all users. For example, if the boundary expands from this black line to this blue line, I mean nothing happens to users like this, right? It is always connecting to the macro base station nevertheless. However, for some users, you are taking a larger term from the denominator and a smaller term from the denominator and substituting it with the largest term in the which was in the numerator. Right. As a result, if you try to plot your SINR coverage probability, at some gamma, let's say, and you plot it versus Q2, you would see that there is a maxima which occurs at Q2 equal to 1. Okay. At Q2 tends to infinite, so as this tends to infinite, this saturates at a value, which means that this is the SINR value or SINR coverage probability that you get in case only one of the tires were present, which was phi 2. And this is the value when Q2 equal to 0. Is the coverage probability. So this is the, naturally these might not be equal to each other. Okay, so let me try to draw a more elaborate version of this thing. Okay, so the value at which it saturates to, this is the coverage probability of users such that only phi 1 is present. And at Q2 equal to 0 is the coverage probability of the users such that only phi 2 is present. Okay. Naturally, if you increase P2 and or if you change P1 and P2, these values would change, which means, can you tell me what would happen if P2 is increased? Suppose P2 was previously 5. So this black line belongs to P2 equal to 5. Suppose P1 is always very large, let's say it's 100. Can you tell me how would the line of P2 equal to 10 look like?
Sir, I think the line would have a higher SINR at one.
It would have a higher SINR at one naturally, because some of the users which are connecting to this base station of type 2 or tier 2 will be having now an augmented signal. I mean, not always. We have seen that increasing power not always increases the SINR, right? Because the interference also increases. But generally speaking, it would happen. It would start from a higher value when only tier 2 base stations are present. Naturally, this is not always that is going to happen. But of course, as it saturates, it should come to the same value as if only tier 1 type was present. Okay, so these kind of experiments is something which you can do on your own, is try to find out the SINR. Again, these are all simulations, what I'm asking you to do. We have not gone into the analytical part of it. Okay, what you do is generate these two types of poison point processes, connect to the one which is giving you the highest power, highest biased power, and just simply find out whether SINR is greater than this threshold or not, right? And try to plot this SINR coverage probability with Q2. Okay. Now let us see what would happen, or how would we be characterizing the performance of these users analytically. So what we are interested in is SINR. So now there are two variants of SINR. SINR when you connect to a base station of tier type 1, and SINR when you connect to a base station of tier type 2. So SINR, if we connect to a base station of tier type 1, how would you write it? It would be simply the power of tier 1, k, let's say d1 to the minus alpha, or let's say all the base stations locations, so BS distances, tier phi 1 is denoted by x1 and tier phi 2 is denoted by x2. Okay. So I will not go into the detailed derivation of it, because you will be able to do it yourselves. It follows similarly to what we have done for a single tier network, but there is an additional nuance to it, and I will discuss that a bit more thoroughly. Okay, so if we start with writing this SINR expression, which is p1 k x1 to the minus alpha, of course there is h1 as well, or h1x, let's call it hx1, and we have the noise. And what would be the interference term? Can someone recall?
Everything except that x1.
Right. So it is the sum. Now there are two sums. You have sum of all xi's that belong to phi 1. There is an abuse of notation here, because xi's are the distances, not the points. When I say xi's belongs to phi 1, okay, let me be more clear. So x1 vector belonging to phi 1, and xi is the distance of it. So tier 1 x1 or xi is the distance of xi, okay, p1 k xi to the minus alpha h of xi. Now there is another summation, which is now yi belonging to phi 2 p2 k yi minus alpha h of yi. This one except x1. So is this formulation clear for everyone, or do you want me to repeat it once? Okay. So this SINR term, when you are connecting to the base stations of tier type 1, is simply a signal which you are receiving from the nearest base station of tire type 1, E1K x1 to the minus alpha, divided by the noise and the sum of the interferences. So these are interferences from phi 1, which means other base stations of tire type 1 except the nearest one with which you are connected to. And these are the interferences from phi 2. Okay, so if we follow the same method of whether my SINR when I'm connecting to tire type 1 is greater than gamma or not, if we have the previously assumed assumptions, which are all the fading are Rayleigh distributed and these locations of these base stations are Poisson point processes and so on, we would move in the same direction and we would reach the expected value. Or if we just simply evaluate the first step, which is to keep HX1 on the left hand side and calculate whether it is greater than gamma or not, we would reach exp of gamma n0 by p1k x1 minus alpha, exp of minus gamma sum of p1k xi minus alpha by p1k x1 minus alpha, and exp of minus gamma sum, so this is over phi 1 except x1, this is p2k y1 minus alpha or yi minus alpha divided by p1k x1 minus alpha. Okay, so all these terms individually contain p1. That's why we would take the expectation with respect to, sorry, x1, all this term contains x1. Naturally, we will take the expectation with respect to x1 in the end, as we had done previously when there was two terms. Now there are three terms, out of which the second term is straightforward to evaluate, and you have done it already. So let's call this expectation with respect to x1 outside, which means the first term now becomes a constant term in case your x1 is fixed. The rest of them, if we want to evaluate the expectation with respect to the, so this is xhi's and hyi's, so we have hxi's and also independent phi i's, so phi 1 except x1. And exp of gamma sum of p1k xi minus alpha h of xi by p1k x1 minus alpha, right? Let's call this term B. And similarly, we have a term C, which is an expected value with respect to h of yi phi 2 exp of minus gamma summation of p2kx2, or sorry, yi minus alpha h of yi. I hope I have not completely lost you. Please, I mean, interrupt me at any time which is where things get a bit unclear. But since it is straightforward from what we have done in the previous classes, I'm moving a bit faster here. But at any case or at any instance you think that nothing is making sense, please feel free to stop me. Okay, so this term B, the evaluation of this term B, do you remember how we did it? So can someone just elaborate how we evaluate this term B? So term B is simply the expected value. So it consisted of three steps. So if you simply just tell me those three steps, I would be happy to proceed.
So this can be written like product of exponents, and since all HIs would be independent,
mm-hmm. So this is n product of exp minus gamma. So p1 disappears from numerator and denominator, so does k. Xi minus alpha h xi divided by x1 minus alpha. Right, this is the first step, which is the exponential of the summation becomes the product of the exponentials, and this becomes equal to, so here it is still h of xi and phi 1 except x1.
This is the product of expectations.
Right, so expected value of the point process remains outside, and first we will evaluate the expectation with respect to the independent identically distributed fading variables. So which is simply the Laplace transform with respect to h of xi. So it becomes 1 by 1 plus gamma xi minus alpha by x1 minus alpha. I hope again this part is clear. This follows from the Laplace transform of h of xi. And finally, we use what?
PGFL expression exponent. Right.
So this becomes the exp of minus lambda integral of 1 minus 1 by 1 plus gamma x. So xi becomes a dummy variable, which becomes r to the minus alpha by x1 minus alpha r d theta, right? So where theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, of course, but r goes from, can someone tell, remember what r goes from?
D1 to infinite.
X1 to infinite.
X1 to infinite, right. So now with this in your mind, since you are well versed with this kind of an evaluation, can you tell me what term C would be? So I can scroll up and show you what are the differences between term B and term C. Okay, let me try to write it. Okay. Term C is simply the expected value with respect to phi 2, right? And with respect to of h y i's, the expression exp of minus gamma summation p2, k disappears from numerator and denominator, yi minus alpha h of yi divided by p1 x1 minus alpha. Okay, the first couple of terms or first couple of steps remain the same, which means the exponential of the sum becomes the product of exponentials. HYIs are simply other fading terms which are also Rayleigh distributed, because as I had told you already, this origin of fast fading, why does it occur and how do we take that into account? We discussed that it doesn't depend on how far your base station is, how tall or how powerfully it is transmitting or not. It is just the fluctuation around the mean power, and simply it would be Rayleigh distributed here as well. So where we reach at is a similar term, which is exp of minus lambda 2 here, because we are taking the PGFL with respect to the second type of base station tire, which is phi 2. Couple of integrals, of course, theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, 1 minus 1 by whatever we have, 1 plus gamma times r to the minus alpha, p2 would be here as well, divided by x1 minus alpha p1. It was not there previously because p1 was equal to p2 for all the base stations of tire type t1.
X1 it should be r, right?
Sorry,
so in place of x1 it should be r.
Are you sure? So r is simply the distances of the interfering base stations.
Okay, we have replaced the ith term to the dummy variable.
Yeah. So again, PGFL is with respect to this guy.
Yes.
So what is this guy? This is the other base stations except X1. So here, PGFL is with respect to this guy. So phi 2 is the all the base stations of tire type T2 or tire type phi 2. Okay. Here X1 remains the same as before. It is simply, I mean, whether in this case, whether you are considering the interference from the base station of type T1 or phi 1 or base station of type phi 2, your serving power remains still the same, right? Your serving power is still X1. Although we are evaluating the SINR when you are connecting to tire phi 1, your interferences from all type 1, interference from all type phi 2, but the serving is from the nearest one of phi 1. Is it clear? Which means that the for evaluation of the term C, we will not assume that we are connecting to the nearest one of phi 2. You are still connected to only single base station, which is the nearest one of phi 1. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If this is clear, now you will tell me the only, let's say, crucial part in this entire evaluation is from where to where. Remember that we are calculating the SINR coverage probability given that you are associated to a base station of tire phi 1. Right? So that is SINR 1. When I say this phrase, that given that you are associated to a base station of tire phi 1, from where to where the interfering base stations belonging to tire phi 2 can belong to? So what do you think would be here? And what do you think would be here?
Sir, can interfering base station of phi 2 be closer than X1?
You tell me. So what the only
considering the
information. Sorry, yes.
So I'm telling, as we are considering the maximum SNR, so we should not be connected to the network of the phi 2 less than the phi 1.
Yeah, I mean, the only thing that we have, or the only information we have until this point, is that we have connected to a base station of tire type phi 1, right? That means when we had considered the association, right, at that point, we had only compared the compared the powers received, and it turned out that the power received from the nearest one of phi 1 is greater than the nearest one of phi 2. Okay. Given this is the only information we have, right, and we know that the nearest base station of phi 1 is X1, can you tell me from where to where the nearest the base stations, interfering base stations of type 2 can belong to?
So maybe X1 to infinity again.
Okay, this is one option, X1 to infinity. Somebody else was trying to say something else, I think. Vaibhav, I think you were trying to say something else.
So I was saying this same thing, still X1 to infinity. Mm.
Right. So this is a, this, I understand that this comes naturally while thinking about it. But to go back to one of the questions, I think, I don't know who was it who asked this, that whether the interfering base station can be closer to the serving base station. To answer this question, remember that while comparing or while deciding the association, we really did not worry about out of these two closest base station which was closer. We only worried about out of these two closest base stations which was more powerful, right? So to give an example, suppose a user is located at this plus sign, and we are trying to compare two base stations. One is located at this circle and the other one is located at this X. Okay. Suppose this guy is at 10 meter, right? And this guy is at 1 meter, right? So the power that you received from the blue one is simply K P1 and 1 to the minus alpha, which is 1. So 1 to the minus 2. And the power that you receive from the red one is K P2 10 to the minus 2. Okay. So P1, you are so K disappears from both sides. P1, you are going to compare essentially with P2 by 100. Yes, which means that if a base station of this red X, which let's say is tire 2 or red base station tire, if it is located 100 times farther than a blue base station, if the power of this red base station is 100 times more than the blue base station, you will still connect to the red base station. I think it's straightforward. Is there someone who didn't who did not get this part? Is it clear for everyone? Just this revelation of the fact, in some sense, that you can always connect to a base station which is located farther from you. In fact, much farther from you, as long as, it depends on what powers they are transmitting with. So if this is okay, now tell me that suppose you have connected with this red base station, let's say this is of tire 5-1. And this is of tire 5-2. What should be the distances, or what should be the allowable distances while you try to incorporate or try to account for all the interfering base stations of type 5-2? Basically, what are the limits of this R, of this term C? Anyone?
So zero to infinite.
Again, can you? Yeah, this is another option which would, after this discussion, would come naturally to your mind. Well, but is it really true?
So I have a doubt. Actually, we are calculating the interference because of the base station 5-2.
Yeah.
So it should be from zero to infinity, right? Because every station, either it is far away or near, should contribute to some interference.
That's absolutely true. But now we have this additional information that we are calculating the SINR coverage probability conditioned on the fact that you have connected to tire 1. When you have this additional information that you have actually connected to tire 1, you cannot be very sure that it should always, the base station of type 5-2 starts from zero, right? Because if it would have started from zero, you would have connected to it.
Yeah, yes, yeah. But again, then we are focusing on the distance. You said that we should not only, it is not only depending on the distance. It's depending on the there might be a base station near to us which is contributing to the interference, but still to the other base station. So
absolutely, that was the point that I tried to make to get you out of this idea that it would be only beyond the red guy. It can be nearer than the red guy as well. Okay, but does it mean that it can be anywhere? That's the second part of the question, right? So Aditya, I think you were about to say something.
Yes, sir. I was just saying that we only connect to 5-1 because we get more power from it. So we should consider all the base stations of 5-2 from 0 to infinite. Same point that Arnav was making.
Mm-hmm. But again, I gave you an example, right? Why you should not think about... Yeah, tell me.
So, sir, beyond 5-1 also, I would connect to 5-1 because it's transmitting high power.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's for sure. If the blue guy is located here, you would also always connect to 5-1.
But so there is also a certain range, right, beyond which I would not be able to connect to 5-1.
You mean 5-1 is... fixed and you are moving this 5-2, or you think 5-2 is fixed and you are moving 5-1?
I am moving 5-1. For example, 5-1 is really, really far. But so in that case, my high power would be cancelled by that distance.
Absolutely, that's true. But for the moment, we are at a stage where we have a fixed 5-1's distance. Not 5-1, but the nearest one of 5-1. Because you remember, we are calculating all these expectations inside and given some x1, right? That means Okay, if I come back to this specific numerical example, I'll give you a numerical example and you would be able to derive for yourself. So to answer your question, Vaibhav, for the moment we have fixed this red axis and we are looking for the locations of these blue circles where it would have been, they would have been considered as interferences. Okay. So for the moment, if we forget about the modified, let's say path loss model, let's call, let's call this distance 2 meters and this distance as 10 meters. Okay. So the power that I have received from the base station of tire type phi 1 is P1 10 to the minus 2 and K. Let's forget about K for the moment. And P2 2 to the minus. For the moment, let's say that these things I don't know. The distances I don't know. I know only the powers. So let's say P1 is of power, let's say 10 watts. And this guy is of power 1 watt. Right? And I am interested in the fact that where my distance of this tire phi 2 is located so that I consider them as legitimate interfering base stations. Because if they would have been closer to a certain distance, it would not have been the case that I am connecting to tire type phi 1. Okay, so in this example, can you tell me D2 should be where? So for example, if D2 equal to 1, with which base station do you connect to?
So maybe we can decide upon the distance on which both the SMR are comparable.
Exactly. So that's the point I was going to. So here you see that if D2 equal to 1, this power received is 1. And in this case, the power received is always 1 by 10. That means 1 is not a valid value, because if a D2 would have been located at 1, you would have actually connected to phi 2, right? So D2 must be at least as high such that it becomes equal to this guy. So if I call this lower limit as L, of course, D2 can be anywhere until infinite, right? That's not a problem. If I call this lower limit at L and remove these things, we have to find a certain L such that P2 L to the minus alpha becomes equal to P1 X1 to the minus alpha. That means L is equal to, or if we continue this evaluation, L is equal to P1 by P2 to the minus 1 by alpha X1. Is this clear? I mean, once you see it like this, it should be straightforward. But it's, I mean, if you just would have put 0 here, or if you would have put X1 here, your simulations and your analytical expressions would not match. And in the end, you would predict some different things than actually what the network operator is experiencing. Okay. It's a very simple subtlety, but it changes the dimensioning or the network planning rules very much. Okay. So this part is clear. How did we arrive at this lower limit of this integration? Or is there some doubt yet? I mean, you can convince yourself with these special cases that what happens when the powers are equal. When the powers of both these tires are equal, then the second, when the powers of both these base stations are, both these tires are equal, you connect to tire 1 only when the tire 1 base station is closer to the base station of tire 2. Right? So that means L becomes X1, which means base station 2 lies, or the interference from the base station 2 lies beyond X1. Okay. Any question? Because if not, we can finalize the overall coverage probability, which is the coverage probability. So the coverage probability at some gamma is the coverage probability PC1 given that you are associated to tier phi 1 multiplied by the probability that you are associated to tier phi 1 plus the coverage probability of tier, I mean, if you are connected to tier base station of tier phi 2 multiplied by the probability that you are actually connected to a base station of tier phi 2. So this is, I mean, this follows from the expression for joint probability, right? So this is the probability of coverage, which means SINR 1 is greater than gamma and phi 1 is the base station with which you are connected to. So this is the probability of SINR given gamma, given that you are associated with phi 1 multiplied by the probability that you are actually associated with phi 1. Okay, this first term is the thing that we have derived until now, which is this guy. This is PC1 given that you are associated to phi 1, right? We have gone about this calculation by this assumption that phi 1 is the one with which you are connected to. That's why our serving power or the signal power became x1 to the minus alpha and so on, and the interferences varied accordingly. Is this clear? Or any questions or any discussions regarding this which you want to have?
So sir, just be clear that L is that point where I'm getting same power from my phi 1 and phi 2s.
Exactly.
And yeah, after this L, my phi 2 would act as interference.
Right. So for every given x1, you can always find an L within which no phi 2 is located. Because if there were a phi 2 within that L, they would have been contributing a larger power than the nearest point of phi 1. Okay. Now this L depends on this power P1 and P2, right? So in case P1 is greater than P2, so let's try to visualize this. Okay, so this is the point where your user is located, right? And let's say this is the point where your serving base station is located. Okay, so this red cross is your serving base station, which means all the other base stations of this type red cross are beyond this circle. Are you convinced of this fact? This is something which we have done in the initial days of the class, which means that if I am considering only one tier networks and I am associating with respect to highest received power, it is equivalent to associating with a nearest base station. If there is only one tier, that means if this guy is my serving base station, there are no other red crosses nearer to it, within this circle, basically. Now, think about a power P1 to be greater than P2. So P2 is the transmit power of the second tier base stations. Okay. Now, if P1 is greater than P2, it can well happen that there are circles inside, there are these red circles inside this distance of R. Let's call this distance of X1. Are you convinced of this proposition or this assertion that if P1 is greater than P2, then there is possible that these blue circles are inside X1?
Yes, sir. We would need a larger distance with P1.
Mm-hmm.
If the power is more, hence we have a chance that smaller radius P2 might be inside. And in that case, it would associate with P2, right?
No, that's the exact point I'm trying to say. That if P1 is greater than P2, right, that means that there can still be blue circles inside the radius of distance x1, and you still associate with phi 1. By the way, this is for phi 1 and this is for phi 2. Okay, if p1 is greater than p2, that means whatever power you are getting from this red cross guy, you are getting it larger than any other blue base stations, right? But it does not always mean that this blue stuff is outside the nearest red base station. That's what we saw in this numerical example. That suppose, I mean, the one which you are getting from this red cross is P1 X1 minus alpha, right? And the one which you are getting from the blue cross, blue circles, is P2, let's say Y1 minus alpha. The nearest one, let's say, is Y1 minus alpha. Okay. And suppose X1 is, let's say, 10 meters, right? This is 10 to the minus 2, right? And P1, or let's say P2, is, let's say, 1 watt, right? So in case P1 is, let's say, 1000 watt, which means this makes it equal to 10, that means Y1 to the minus alpha can very well be below 10. Is this part clear?
Yes, sir. So basically, we are just deciding on basis of that L, not on this basis of X1.
Right. So X1, P1, and P2, all three play a role. Okay. So the first assertion is that this blue circles can be less than 10. Okay. You can put some value which is evaluating to less than 10 here, and you would still get this inequality to be holding. Okay. The second assertion is that although these blue circles can be inside this X1, they cannot be anywhere. They cannot, for example, go within a certain, let's say, exclusion region or something. That's what you are mentioning as L. When P1 is greater than P2, this L is less than X1. On the other hand, if P1 is less than P2, this L is very well a circle which is outside of X1. Which means if you are connecting to a less powerful base station, which means in this case, a base station of this red cross type, which has a lower transmit power, the interfering base stations should necessarily be located outside a larger circle, because if they were located inside this circle, probably their received power from these circles would be larger than this red cross. Are these three things clear? That the interfering base stations, the other tire base stations, assertion one is they can actually be located anywhere in this network. However, they cannot be located, second assertion, they cannot be located within a certain distance given by some L. The third assertion is that if P1 is greater than P2, L is less than X1. If P1 is less than P2, L is greater than X1. Are these three things clear? I mean, if it is not clear, please let me know. I mean, we are approaching the end of this concept. What would follow is probably a demonstration of how do you simulate such a network, but we will not do it today. Rather, I think it's important to just focus on this particular concept and clarify this thing. Is it clear for everyone?
Yes, sir.
Okay, if it is clear for everyone, I'll add on a final, let's say, bit of complication, is that suppose now you have done your association. Remember, how did we decide L? L was dependent on the association, right? We have found out some L only because we knew that we are calculating the SINR given that we are connecting to Phi1. Now, suppose that you have done your association by considering a certain cell range expansion parameter Q2 for tire 2. Okay. In that case, can you help me to derive what L would be? Or would L be any different? By the way, remember that never mind what Q1 or Q2 or these bias parameters were, while you try to write the expression for SINR, Q doesn't appear here, which is to reinforce this fact that even with cell range expansion or load balancing in 4G, 5G networks, or biasing or offloading is a very big topic for 5G. Okay. So even while we are considering these facts that our association is done using biasing, while doing the performance analysis, which means while we are calculating the SINR, Q1, Q2 does not appear anywhere in this expression. Where does it appear? It appears in the association. Remember, biasing is the one which is only controlling the association. So if I say that Q2 is the bias parameter which I have employed in the base stations of tire type phi 2, right? Which means the power received from the base stations of tire type phi 2, I have augmented virtually with the parameter Q2. Can you tell me what value of L would be in case I am calculating the SINR coverage probability given that I am associated to phi 1? The question is clear? Yes, no?
So here L, if my Q2 increased, Q2 is basically that bias for phi 2, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if my Q2 is increasing, then that means my radius would increase, after which I would be connecting to P1 or phi 1.
Right.
So it should directly be proportional.
Yes, but to a certain power difference, which means that, I mean, if you go back to, I mean, if you for the moment only come back to the equations, right, what we are now supposed to compare is simply P1 X1 minus alpha to Q2 P2 L minus alpha. That is what decides our association, right? Previously, we were only thinking of whether P2 L1 L minus alpha was greater than or less than P1 X1 minus alpha. If it was less than, then I connect to tire 1. If it is greater than, I connect to tire 2. Now instead, I have to consider Q2 P2 L minus alpha with P1 X1 minus alpha. As a result, L becomes so it's a direct constant which multiplies with power, but again to some constraints with respect to the power. Okay, so it's not a directly proportional or inversely proportional thing. It would depend on what actually alpha is. Okay, so these power terms as compared to these distances are related to each other subject to a power law governed by this path loss exponent. So in case I am using my biased association rule, my distances from which my interfering base stations of tire type 2 goes from are Q2 to, this term L to infinity. You can visualize it by putting Q2 equal to 0 and Q2 equal to 1. Okay, what happens when Q2 equal to 0? Can you tell me what happens when Q2 equal to 0? L will be 0, right? So Q2 equal to 0. Sorry, yes. Yeah, Q2 equal to 0 means actually you are connect. Q2 equal to 0 actually means you are connecting to base station of tire type 1 always. Okay, that means even if in this example, if there was this blue circle very near to you as well, you are multiplying it with this received power, a term which is 0. That means you are always connecting to this red cross, no matter where this blue guy is located. And accordingly, this equation is revealing, and as you mentioned correctly, L will be 0, which means the interfering base stations can lie anywhere from 0 to infinite. Okay. Q2 equal to infinite. Yeah.
Sir, here, so when Q2 is 0, we are seeing that as if only we are always connected with X1.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, and sir, on the plot that you had drawn above, a couple of pages back.
Mm-hmm.
Sir, here when Q2 is 0, shouldn't it be like coverage probability such that only phi 1 is present?
Ah, yes, you are correct. Absolutely. So this guy is actually, I don't know with which I multiplied. Yeah, I multiplied it with the second tire. So this is when phi 1 is present, and this is the one which is only phi 2 is present. Okay. So when I say such that only phi 2 is present, it doesn't mean that the interference is only from phi 2. It means while associating you are only considering the base stations of phi 2. Okay. Is it clear? I mean, there is a bit of, I mean, this is incorrect on my part to say it is the coverage probability of user such that only phi 2 is present. So it is the coverage probability of the users such that only phi 2 is present for association. And this is the coverage probability of the user such that only phi 1 is present for association. Is this clear? I mean, for association, you are considering only phi 1 or phi 2 in these two extreme cases. Although the coverage probability itself, I mean, the other base stations are not disappearing, right? Just because you have put in a parameter which is controlling or virtually augmenting or decreasing the power doesn't mean that the other tire has disappeared, right? The coverage probability itself actually depends on where you are located. I mean, where the other base stations are located as well. Is this clear?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there are a couple of special cases. This the special case was this q1 equal to 0 and q1 equal to 1 becomes L equal to whatever we previously derived L as. The other special case is in case of non-co-channel transmissions. So this is the case of co-channel transmissions. In case of non-co-channel transmissions, which mean if phi 1 base station type and phi 2 base station type both operate in different frequencies, which means if you are connected to phi 1 or any base station of type phi 1, you perceive interference from only the other base stations of the same type. You do not have this other term from the other tire, right? So in that case, right? In that case, the SINR coverage probability or the conditional SINR coverage probability, given that you are associating to a base station of tire phi I, which can be phi 1 or phi 2, it follows similarly as the case of single tire association. On the other hand, what interesting thing becomes is that in case of for non co-channel transmissions. Yeah. And this is, I think, I'll give you as homework. So suppose you are considering a non-co-channel transmission, which means phi 1 is interfered by other base stations of only phi 1. Phi 2 is interfered by other base stations of only type phi 2. Is Q2 equal to 1 or does Q2 equal to 1 maximize the coverage probability? Is the question clear? Because previously, when we were plotting coverage probability with respect to Q2, we understood that taking a user away from a more powerful base station and putting it at the less powerful base station decreases the SINR coverage because you are taking a smaller term from the denominator and putting it in the numerator, right? That's why from Q2 equal to 1, even if you go on the left hand side and if you go on the right hand side, your SINR coverage probability decreases, right? That's very clear. On this side, you are taking from the macro and putting them in the small cell, or taking from phi 1 and putting them into phi 2. On this side, you are taking them from, this side naturally does not occur in real world scenarios, but since we are currently discussing only the mathematical construct, this means you are taking users away from the small base station and putting them in the macro, which means, again, if you visualize it, you are putting a blue circle which is now smaller than the black one. Okay. In both these cases, our SINR coverage probability was decreasing if we moved away from this one, Q2 equal to 1. Does this hold, right, in case there are no co-channel transmissions? I mean, a yes, no answer for now would suffice. Can anyone tell me whether this will always hold? No guesses?
Sir, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
Actually, when I declare MVD, which are
Sorry,
reducing
I
the radius
can't
of
hear you
contour.
very clearly. Can you repeat it, please?
Yes, sir. Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
So when we are decreasing Q2, means we are decreasing the radius for small cell, why is the SI energy decreasing?
All right, that's a good question, and the reason follows similarly. So, for example, if you have this microwave station, right, and you have this small cell, right, and suppose previously your radius was this guy, okay, which means for a user like this, it's best for him or her or it to connect to the small cell. Right, because it is within this inner radius, which means all the people who are inside this smaller circle have a stronger power from this blue base station. Now, when we are decreasing Q2, which means we are decreasing this guy's effective coverage area. So let me draw this again. Right. So for if I decrease the coverage area, which means my coverage area is like this now. So for a user like this, which is still optimal to be connected to the blue small base station, is now have been forcefully taken away from it because of this new coverage area, which is the blue one. And we have forcefully connected it to the macro base station. So although this one was the optimal one, we have asked him to connect to this larger base station. Is it clear why the SNR coverage decreases?
Yes, I got
Yeah. Okay. So that was the reason that even we so and the other way around was this increasing of this blue circle. Okay. So from going from this actual boundary, which let me draw it with red. So going away from this red boundary, whether inwards or outwards, decreases the coverage area in case of co-channel transmissions. However, now you know that in case when there are no co-channel transmissions, you can actually increase the coverage a bit because of our previous discussion where we started with. Okay, let me go back to this case where my SINR is something which we are deciding after the association, right? So in this case, suppose the red base station is giving me a lower received power, but it would be beneficial for me to connect to this blue. Sorry, yeah, it would be beneficial for me to connect to the red one still because the interference is very low. It's only coming from these two guys. So here, even when we have Q2 equal to 1, Q2 equal to 1 means connect to the one which is giving you the more power. So here, let us assume that this one was giving it the more power, not only because it is closely located, but possibly it has higher, let's say, transmit power. So let's say this one is P2 and P1, and let's say P2 is greater than P1. Naturally, Q2 equal to 1 would mean you connect to this blue guy, right? But it sometimes makes sense to connect to a farther one like this guy only because the SINR would be better because only few interferers are present. So naturally, or intuitively, you might argue that for this case, Q2 equal to 1 might not be an optimal one. So this is something which we can discuss in the next class or in the office hours. But as a homework, I would like you to also try it out. Not analytical expressions like this, but simply simulate the network, right? Plot the coverage probability. I mean, you would have already done it for this guy, this one. So try to generate this same plot for co-channel and non-co-channel transmissions, and then we take that discussion forward.
Sir,
Yeah.
yeah, one last thing. Last day when you were showing all sorts of simulations and plots with SINR, you had an extra section of code.
Yeah.
So yeah, so did you share that extra section? Because I was unable to find it.
I'm not sure if I had uploaded the updated part. So I think I had previously shared the one which contained only the simulation, and the extra part that I had added were contained the analytical expression, right?
It was the analytical expression only. Okay.
Yeah. There's
that
nothing.
Can, yeah. Okay.
So although I can share it with you, I would like still, I mean, I think I cannot focus or I cannot emphasize this part enough, that you have to start yourself writing the codes, right? There is no other way for you to get very familiar with this subject and then use it in your, probably your job or later on in your higher studies or research or whatever. Okay. The only way for you is to, I mean, not be a bit lazy, but start writing pieces of code. And I think I have given you enough examples, hands-on, to show how you generate such networks. Okay. So by the next class, let us hope that you have a bit more experience on doing these things, at least the one which was there in the quiz. Okay, try to simulate that one and the one which we discussed right now. Okay, so see you in the office hours, which is on Wednesday. Thank you, guys.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks.